Our challenge is that with floating point, we can't tell what the real difference is because we can't store enough digits. We can add more precision to the number by storing more digits in the mantissa. When we distinguish between single precision arithmetic and double precision and quadruple precision, mainly we're distinguishing between the number of digits in the mantissa. There are a few other ways we extend the range of floating point numbers too. Most floating point numbers have more than one digit in the exponent. And floating point numbers can be negative as well as positive. You can have minus 1.0 as well as plus 1.0. To achieve this, in terms of representation, we add another storage box for another sign. This storage box holds the sign of the mantissa instead of the other sign box, which holds the sign of the exponent. For example, minus 1/10, the number you get if you subtract 1 from 0.9, minus 1/10 would be minus 1.0 times 10 to the minus 1. This slide gives you a puzzle to work on with your friends. Should be easy, but I'm not going to give you the answer. Assume that you have 4 significant digits and a sign bit for the mantissa, and 2 significant digits with a sign bit for the exponent. What should the results be for these two calculations? Modern computers don't usually store numbers as decimal digits. They store numbers in bits instead. Bits are binary digits. Instead of decimal arithmetic, computers do binary arithmetic. So for the next few slides, I'll keep showing you number boxes, but these boxes are binary instead of decimal. They can have a 0, or they're going to have a 1. That's it. Here we see the decimal number 15 represented in binary. It's got 1 times 2 to the 3, plus 1 times 2 to the 2, plus 1 times 2 to the 1, plus 1 times 2 to the 0. Decimal 15 is the same as 1, 1, 1, 1. This slide shows a bunch of other binary conversions. For example, decimal 132 is binary 10000100. We can add binary numbers just like we added decimal numbers, except that we overflow a lot more quickly. In decimal, 5 plus 5 is 1, 0. We call that 10. In binary, 1 plus 1 is 1, 0. We call that 2. We can also write this as 0000000010, which is how we show 2 within an 8-bit binary number. The biggest number you can store in 8 bits is 255. Add anything to 255, and if you're working in 8 bits, you get an overflow. Some programmers still work with 8-bit numbers, even on computers with 64-bit words. Their goal is to fit their code and data into the tiniest amount of space possible. Occasionally, this goal is necessary because processors designed to control equipment sometimes come with very little memory. But whether a restriction to 8-bit arithmetic is necessary or just somebody showing off, the risk of overflow with 8-bit arithmetic is very high. If you think calculations might be only 8 bits or 16 bits, you really need to test for overflows. As with decimal numbers, we can have negatives as well as positives. In binary, we interpret the first bit as the sign bit. So in an 8-bit word, instead of standing for 2 to the 7th, a 1 on the top bit means the number is negative. I've mentioned word size a few times. The central processor fetches data from memory in chunks. Older processors typically fetched 8 bits or 12 bits at a time. Newer processors typically fetch 32 or 64 bits at a time. Whatever is the natural working size for a computer, 8, 12, 32, 64, whatever, that's what we call its word size. If a computer typically operates on 64 bits of memory at a time, it's a 64-bit computer with 64-bit word size. The size of an integer, that is the number of significant digits in an integer, is often determined by the programming language rather than by the computer chip. This makes it possible for us to run the same program with the same precision of calculations on many different types of computers. So for any particular computer, what the programming language treats as an integer might span more or less than one computer word of memory. Because integers are given different amounts of storage space in different programming languages, we often talk about minint and maxint. Minint is the smallest value an integer can take on this system or in this language. Maxint is the largest value. Java supports 4 types of integers, spanning 8 bits through 64 bits. I've also seen integers with 12 bits, 24 bits, 48 bits, and 128. When you do test design, do most of your work with general limits. Talk about maxint and minint instead of locking yourself down to an exact number of digits. Similarly, when you document your tests, do that in terms of general limits too. fill in specific numeric constants when you have to. But the more tied your test designs, your test docs, and your test code is to the numeric constants, the faster they become obsolete, the harder they are to reuse on another program or another system, and the harder they are to modify if the programmers change integer precision on the software under test. Now, floating point. Floating point arithmetic in binary is essentially the same as floating point in decimal. In a 32-bit word, the top bit is the sign bit for the mantissa. Then the next 8 bits are assigned byte for the exponent. Then the mantissa has 23 binary digits of precision, which works out to about 10 decimal significant digits. We can also have double precision arithmetic. This uses 64 bits and gives us 52 significant binary digits. Along with binary digits and decimals, we often talk about hexadecimal numbers. In a hexadecimal digit, the values run from 0 to 15 instead of 0 to 1 or 0 to 9. We can store characters in memory, not just numbers. We encode them. The most widely discussed encoding system is ASCII, the American Standard Code for Information Interchange. ASCII encodes letters, numbers, and some other characters like spaces and exclamation marks. For example, the code for 2 is 50. ASCII was invented for teletypes, so it only encodes a few characters. It stores everything in 8 bits. Some of the things it encodes are actually teletype commands, like ring the teletype's bell or make a vertical tab. These days, a lot of people use Unicode instead of ASCII. Unicode stores characters in 16 bits and it handles a lot of different languages. Let's sum up. When a program reads a 32-bit word from memory, it interprets those bits. It might interpret them as an integer, a floating point number, sequence of letters, some other way. There's no way to tell from looking at a 32-bit pattern what type of data was stored in it. All we can see are 32 ones and zeros. The program's interpretation of a word of data as an integer might be correct or it might not. We might have a bug. Someone stored letters, but the program read them as a number. Along with storing individual numbers or characters, we can store data in data structures. Think of a data structure as a specific way to organize a collection of numbers or characters. My goal in mentioning them is just to make you aware of them. Most data stored in most programs is stored in data structures. You should know about them. To learn more, take a data structures course. This is one of the early courses in the computer science curriculum. It'll tell you why and when one structure is more useful than another. It'll also tell you what kind of risks are associated with different structures, what kind of bugs, and when one performs faster than another for the same task. In the slides that follow, I'll sometimes note errors that are common when dealing with a specific type of data structure. These are not necessarily the most common errors or the most important ones. They're what came to my mind as examples that you'd probably understand that might help you envision the variety of testing issues associated with data structures. The simplest data structure is the string. A string is just a sequence of characters. Another type of data structure is called a record. When you add values into several fields in a dialog box, you're probably filling in a record. An array is a numbered sequence of data of the same type. Imagine an array of integers. We'll call it A. If you ask for A sub 0, you get the first element in the sequence. Ask for A sub 2, you get the third element in the sequence. You can have an array of records. You can have an array of strings. You could easily retrieve the 43rd tax return from a database of tax returns if these records were stored in an array. Lists are like arrays, but more general. For example, we can have a list of lists, and each of the different kinds of lists could point to a different set of records. Maybe one list would contain tax records, and another list would contain mortgage records. So why do we need all these different types of data structures? Well, when we want to store a collection of data, we want to be able to find it later. We want to be able to find it efficiently, and we want to be able to change it efficiently. Each type of data structure makes some types of searches easier and some types of changes easier. A structure that is very fast for some tasks, though, can be painfully slow for others, especially in real-time programs like games. And in programs that work with large amounts of memory, a lot of work goes into optimizing data structures to achieve the right trade-off between speed of the most important operations and the amount of space required in memory or on disk.